So pain, touch, temperature, and pressure. PTTP. Right. It's going to be the same when we talk about the heart. When we mention parietal serous pericardium and visceral. It's going to be the same when we talk about the peritoneum and the abdominal cavity. Parietal and visceral. So visceral will always be sensitive to stretch or tear. Parietal, pain, touch, temperature, and pressure. Right. So most organs that are innervated by, let's say, the example, the stomach, the rectum, will be sensitive to stretch only because they're innervated by the autonomic nervous system. Right. You only feel the pain when it goes beyond the visceral and affects the parietal nerve. That's when you then start to perceive pain. Right. Alright. Then let me briefly talk about the intercostal nerves, then we then talk of the medius nerve. So you have a spinal nerve. Let me take you back to the vertebra. We say it's a vertebra as a body. Then extending from the body, you have pedicles. Let me say the anterior, right? Mm-hmm. But these pedicles, they don't attach in the midline or at the midpoint. They are more inclined superior than this. Right? So confirm if you have, let's say this being a body, you have two processes, you're going to form two notches, a notch above and a notch below, right? Mm-hmm. So can you see the notch above is smaller, right? Because the pedicles are more inclined towards the superior surface, then the notch below is larger, mm-hmm. right? Then you then appreciate that a vertebra will have an intervertebral disc and another vertebra, right? So this inferior vertebral notch will join the smaller superior vertebral notch slightly below, and they form a foramen. Right. That foramen, it's an intervertebral foramen. Inter, it's between two vertebrae. It's different from the vertebral foramen that we said was small and circular. So within that intervertebral foramen, that's where you find a spinal nerve. Don't worry about where it's coming from for now, that's neural, but that's where you find the spinal nerve. Right? When a spinal nerve exits, it's actually very short, about a centimeter. Right? It then divides into two. Anterior rami and posterior rami. For now, everything that you're doing is anterior rami. You talked about the brachial plexus and you say it was anterior rami C5 to T1. Right? So it's anterior rami. Posterior rami is applied the piping. Right? So you have T1 to T12 thoracic nerves. Right? So you also classify these nerves, these thoracic nerves, spinal nerves, into typical and atypical. A typical thoracic nerve will innervate structures in the thorax only. That makes it typical. And that's T3 to T6 only. Those are the only typical thoracic nerves. Why? T1, remember it's going to the brachial plexus, that's upper limb. It's going to form the lower trunk of the brachial plexus, right? Mm-hmm. T2, when we talked about skin innervation, we actually say that the skin in the armpit, right, mm-hmm. it was going to be innervated by the intercostal brachial nerve, which was coming from T2. That alone makes it atypical because it's now supplying the upper limb as well. Right? T3 to T6, yes, they'll supply the thorax only. Then T7 to T12, they supply the thorax as as warm as the abdomen. So those gaps, we'll talk about them again when we get to the abdomen. Right. Let me come back to T2. I once mentioned this when we did brachial plexus. And I said people will say that I have heart pain because they are feeling pain here. Right. So that concept is referred to as referred pain. So pain of the heart can be referred to the skin of the axilla. Why? Remember I said a visceral organ, e.g. the heart, it's supplied by parasympathetic and
sympathetic.
And in your level, you must have said that sympathetic is thoracolumbar from T1 to around L2. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So the T1 to T4 fibers, those are the ones that supply sympathetic to the thorax. From T5 going down, we'll talk about them in the abdomen. Right? So T1 to T4. And notice T2 is included. And it's also supplying the skin. So there is what is known as referred pain. It's sort of like an illusion, but it's there. So you will feel as if the pain is here, because this is a somatic structure. But yet, what is being affected is the heart. Why? Because T2 for the heart, it's going back to the spinal cord, then the cutaneous nerves that are supplying the skin, they're also going back to the spinal cord. So your brain will perceive as if it's actually coming from skin. Because remember, I said somatic structures or parietal structures will actually be sensitive to pain, touch, temperature, and pressure. So you're actually going to perceive as if it is coming from there. That's the same concept that is going to be used in the abdomen. It's mainly talked about in the abdomen, how you have referred pain. Right? So you can have referred pain from structures that are deep, being referred to the skin. When you perceive as if it's the skin that is having a problem, it's either their pain inside or even the stomach or something like that. Just know that pain from the heart can be referred to that. So, maybe out of interest, sake, this intercostal nerve will supply skin, muscles, as well as the parietal, the muscles we've talked about, intercostals. The skin is the skin, the thoracic wall. So, it divides into, or it rather it gives you an anterior intercostal, you supply the skin, that is anterior, and the lateral cutaneous branch as well, you supply the skin of the flanks, right? The lateral cutaneous branch of T2 is what we are calling the intercostal branch, right? That's not really important. Then we now have a thoracic wall, right? That you can now further divide into the mediastina and pleural cavities. Right. But before we divide it, it obviously has an opening and an exit. Right. So you have a superior thoracic aperture and an inferior thoracic aperture. Boundaries for these will not become hard. Why? Superior thoracic aperture, anteriorly you have the upper border of the manubrium. Posteriorly, you have T1, right? Laterally, you have the first rib, because those are the most superior ones. Then, the inferior thoracic aperture, which is the largest, but it's closed by the diaphragm. Posteriorly, you have T12, which is the lowest vertebra in our thoracic wall, right? Anteriorly, you have the lower point of the xiphoid process. Right. Something that I've thought about. At what level do you find the xiphisternal joint? I've just been talking and talking. At what level do you find this if you stand on judgment? That question can also translate to say the body of the sternum extends from which vertebra to which vertebra. You said the manubrium is opposite T3, T4. The sternum angle is between intervertebral disc T4, T5, meaning the body of the manubrium, not the body of the sternum rather, stands at T5, T6, T7, T8, until you get to T9. That's where you have the stiff sternum joint. It lies opposite T9 posterior. Alright. But anyway. I still have time. Anyways. Don't sleep. If you look at the thoracic cavity, for now we are still referring to it as a thoracic cavity. That is the wall of it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you can further divide it into two pleural cavities for the lungs. Right? Then the rest of the space that remains, that's the mediastinum. So the lungs are not the mediastinum. Right? They're the most lateral structures which you actually find in your pleural. Part of the heart is
in the mediastinum.
By part, what you mean?
Like the superior part, I mean, you know.
The heart is actually the mediastinum. Yes. We may get in better way. So, this mediastinum, you can further divide it into a superior mediastinum and an inferior mediastinum. Right? So far, so good.
Yes.
The inferior mediastinum, you can further divide it into anterior, medial, and posterior. So let's talk about the boundaries, how you divide them. To divide superior mediastinum from inferior mediastinum. I only do superior for today, but for the boundaries, I'll do everything. To divide superior from inferior, you are using an imaginary line from the sternal angle. If you draw a line from the sternal angle, go to the vertebral column and touch the lower border of T4. Right? That is your superior mediastinum and above. So posteriorly, you have T1, T2, T3, T4. That's superior mediastinum. Anteriorly, manubrium stem. Right? From T5 up until T12, that's your inferior mediastinum. Right? Then when you get into this inferior mediastinum, God is wonderful, right? You then put your heart at the center, which then divided the mediastinum into an anterior portion and a posterior portion. And when the heart and its great vessels are, that's the middle portion. Not so hard, right?
Mm-hmm.
The heart and its pericardium, which translates to pleura for the lungs, that's the middle mediastinum. Then you have the anterior mediastinum, where in adults you only have ligaments that join the heart to the sternum. But in young children, there is two part of the virus, right? The posterior mediastinum, that's where you have almost everything else that you talk about in the thorax. So let's come back to superior mediastinum and I'll end there. But please try to listen. What do you have in the superior mediastinum? T5. Thymus, great veins, great arteries, trachea, esophagus. Right. The thymus, you know its function, right? Did that physiology. Right? And talk about T lymphocytes, how they come from the bone marrow, then they go and mature in the thymus.
Yes.
Right? That's the function of the thymus. The thymus is actually involutes in puberty, where it starts to degenerate. Right? So in young infants, the thymus space in the superior mediastinum, as well as the anterior mediastinum, which is a part of the inferior. But towards puberty, it starts to involute, right? To not really degenerate, but decrease in size, right? Then, theory that it's actually replaced by fat, right? Then, the great veins, which great veins are we talking about? By now, you appreciate the subclavian veins, right? Where they're coming from, the continuation of the axillary vein and the outer border of the first rib. Just like how we had the subclavian artery becoming axillary artery at that outer border of the first rib. So it's actually coming from the upper limbs, the subclavian veins. And they'll also receive the external jugular veins that are coming from the head and neck. Right? Then they join your other veins that are coming from the head and neck, particularly the internal jugular veins. Then we have formation of brachiocephalic veins.
My jugular veins, I know they're coming from jugular notch.
Jugular notch, which one is a jugular notch?
It is in between the fist cartilage in this other notch. It is between two more notches.
You mean the jugular, if you refer to jugular notch, yeah, the jugular foramen.
No, I mean is an antennae body, the part it comes through the body, in it the jugular notch.
Which part are you referring
to? Is in your pathorax,
Chifambiri. They are not jugular because of that. So when you eventually do your head and neck, you're going to find that I'm terrorizing. There is a jugular foramen where the situate sinus coming from the brain then changes his name to become internal jugular vein. Then there's subsequent brachiocephalic veins that are formed. They then join to form the superior vena cava. I'll talk about that again when we do the heart. But just appreciate that the left brachiocephalic vein crosses between the right brachiocephalic vein. Why should it do that? Because venous return goes to the right side of the heart. Right. Then don't worry about those, we'll talk about them with the heart. Then the arteries, you have the subclavian artery, which we say it will become axillary artery at the outer border of the first rib. And this one I'll talk about a bit. Axillary artery, we say it's divided into three parts. From each part we have branches and it. The subclavian artery is also divided into three parts. It's divided by the scalene muscles, the scalene anterior muscles, which we say we're attaching onto the scalene tubercle that separates subclavian artery from subclavian vein. Right. The first part of the subclavian artery gives you three branches. I know most of them are not important for now. The only important one will be your internal.
Thoracic artery.
Which we say it can also be called the internal mammary artery, because it supplies your breast tissue. Right. The second branch, you have the vertebral artery. Vertebral artery will also supply the brain. Don't worry about it. The third branch is a trunk. A trunk is like this. That means you're giving off an artery like this, which is going to further divide into smaller branches. This third branch is referred to as the thyrocervical trunk. Thyro, it will supply the thyroid, so it will also give you the inferior thyroid artery. Right. Then cervical, it will supply structures to the neck, so it will give you the transverse cervical. second part, it will give you what it is, the cost to a cervical trunk. And then I say the trunk, further divide, right? The reason why I'm mentioning this, I want to end by describing the blood supply for those intercostal spaces. The costo cervical tract, costo, you supply the costal spaces are better. Cervical simply means neck, because that's where you have cervical vertebra. The third part does not give you any branches. It then just continues as the axillary artery at the outer border of the first rib. So let's come back to the intercostal spaces. We say they have their own blood supply, nerve supply, venous drainage, right? So the intercostal spaces, the anterior intercostal space, it's supplied by anterior intercostal arteries. That is the part that is anterior, right? Then the part that is posterior intercostal arteries, right? So here's can I say God's magic? Yes, God's wonderful works, yeah, something like that. The upper six intercostal spaces, anterior ones, they're supplied by the internal thoracic artery, which we just said is coming from the first part of the subclavian artery, right? But then God then decided to say this internal thoracic artery should end at the sixth intercostal space, and it divides into musculophrenic artery and the superior epigastric artery. Gastric means stomach. So this superior epigastric artery is right now going to the abdomen, right? So you're not worried about it. Phrenic means diaphragm, right? So this musculophrenic, we still have it in the thorax. Right. Then I'll ask you something. How many intercostal spaces do we have? Or maybe to rephrase, do we have 11 or 12? 11.
Taka in the gumbling.
Gumbling.
So this is what I'm asking this. We say the upper six internal thoracic artery, the lower five musculophrenic, right? And someone at their house, they have a birthday, their wife, and they say this kid, eh? And they set a question, the lower six intercostal spaces are supplied by the musculophrenic artery. Will that be true or false? I just said the lower six thoracic intercostal spaces are supplied by the musculophrenic. Is that true or false? Yes, we just talked about it. It's false, right? The lower five, musculophrenic. The upper six, internal thoracic. But that's for the anterior parts. The posterior parts, something different. The upper two intercostal spaces, posteriorly, they are supplied by the superior intercostal artery, right? This superior intercostal artery, it's a branch of the costo cervical trunk, which we say it is a branch of the second part of the subclavian artery. Right. Then the lower nine posterior intercostal spaces are supplied by the descending thoracic aorta, which is now the aorta after the arc. They'll supply the posterior lower nine intercostal spaces. Why are you learning this? You appreciate that blood moves from high pressure to low pressure, right? Then you appreciate that by now, if you have arteries in the same space, let's say the third intercostal space, you have anterior intercostal arteries. So something I forgot to mention, anterior intercostal arteries will be two in an intercostal space, but the posterior ones will be one. And you have two anterior ones and one posterior. They are nostrils, or they share the blood. Then someone has a heart problem. I'm sure you by now you must have seen, I won't describe it because it's not good. But there's someone who had caught some IOTA, I think last year from this faculty. I think he's now part final pharmacy. So if you have narrowing of the IOTA and the plant does not go into the descending thoracic aorta, the subclavians, they're coming from the arc. So those already have blood, right? So the internal thoracic artery is blood, which is coming from the subclavian. But now look at the lower nine posterior intercostal spaces. They are now suffering because there is no blood going into the descending thoracic aorta because it is narrowed. That's coarctation of the aorta. And these arteries, the anterior intercostals and the posterior intercostals, you say they anastomose, right? So if this is blood, this doesn't have blood, what's going to happen? The blood will obviously move from this high pressure and go to the low pressure. And it will go with the force. And remember we said van, they are related to the ribs. Vein, artery, nerve. If the artery dilates, it's going to start eroding the rib. That's called rib erosion. Right? So someone will come and say, hey, I think I fractured my bones and something like that. But it's coming from the blood supply side. Right? Questions so far? I think we can end somewhere here. Questions so far?